Hello again, I am Byron Malerba. This is part 1B of the Beyond Ourselves series. That's about extraterrestrial abductions. Now I left off the last episode with a very serious note. We were talking about the abduction in Texas at the point of where I got the phone call from Miss Sousa, who I will explain. She is an investigator for MUFON, and at the time she was also an investigator with Bud Hopkins, whom is a leading ufologist investigator, unfortunately passed away in 2011. I wish I would have been able to speak to him before then, but that didn't happen. So we were last talking about Sousa. Now, I got on the phone with her, and she wanted me to explain to her everything that happened that night. She had said that she got a feeling and decided to call, and we find that very odd, you know, after the fact, that she just happened to call 10 minutes after the abduction and questioned us about what happened. We strongly feel that it is possible that they were doing a field study, and she was possibly watching us from a distance, maybe, you know, I don't know. It's easy to do in that kind of area. You could park a mile away and watch. We don't really know what we did afterwards. I remember that night we went to go watch a man make a brownie in Dallas, and I'm not quite sure why we went there. Maybe just to get the stress off our minds, or I have another theory, and I wrote about it in the story. It's a little out there, but it's possible. I'm not going to explain that right now. On the way home, I remember I snapped a few more photos when I immediately left. I took a picture of the town on the way out, and a couple other pictures. I have no idea why I took them. And then that was it. I don't remember the entire trip home. Nothing at all. Now, my father had told me that I had called at some point on the way home, and he does not remember what I talked about or what I told him. I probably just told him I was on my way back, you know. I was there for 2 weeks. And that's it, you know, as far as the Texas experience. And some things happened shortly afterwards, and we all lost touch with each other again for another 10 years. After 10 years had gone by, all that time I was remembering what happened in Texas. I was writing it down, you know, started telling the story, putting the pieces together, and I decided to try and get in touch with them. So I had typed in their names into the internet, you know, just hoping somebody would show up, you know. And that's where I found Melanie online, and I wrote to her, you know, asking if she remembered me and, you know, the whole Texas experience. And she wrote me back, and we began talking about everything. we talked about what happened in Texas, and I can honestly say that I don't think she remembers too much about it. That's something I'm hoping she would come forward and speak about nowadays. But none of us are expecting that. There's some other issues going on that's preventing that from happening. We'll see. That's all I can say. You know, hopefully she'll watch this video and be inspired to say something about it. But again, we're not expecting that. So, out of the six of us that were involved that I know about, she's probably going to be the only one not to come forward, to be honest. Now, as far as the children at the time, now they're young adults, it's up to them if they want to come forward and speak about this. I'm sure we'd appreciate if they joined us in this, although they have, you know, long lives to live yet, and I don't know if they want to talk about it, and they have every reason not to, and also every reason to talk about it, if, you know, especially if they can remember anything. Again, they were, at the time, they were only 1 and 2 years old, so honestly, they shouldn't remember anything, but I don't know what happened over the years. I believe there were some other incidents with that family after I left. I know there was with me. What this video is about, really, is to get the attention of those involved, help them come forward and speak about this, and it's also to gain the interests of those in the video producing industry, because we'd really like to make a documentary out of this, or maybe even a movie. Honestly, none of us have a lot of money, so we don't have much to invest in this, besides ourselves, our knowledge, and whatever else we can help out with. In the previous video, we went ahead and explained everything from the first sighting to the first abduction in Texas. We talked about who Sam was, who Melanie was, who the children were, and who Miss Sousa is, and Bud Hopkins, and now I'm going to go ahead and explain the second abduction, which happened in Ridge, New York. It was in the middle of the night, I don't even know what time, and I was sleeping in my bedroom. I heard the screen window of the bedroom window being opened. You can hear the screeching of it. And I lifted my head. I looked at the window, and there was two gray aliens staring at me through the window, just like the ones I saw in Texas. I immediately tried to scream to my family for help, and nothing but a low moan came out, and I literally just saw darkness. They turned me off, and that's all I remember. And then I woke up in the morning, and I felt very nervous, and I felt like a stinging, burning sensation just above my groin. So I looked down and I noticed that there was incisions in my skin. They were bleeding very slightly. I immediately got up and I went into the living room, and I had found my mother sitting on the couch, and my father was nowhere in the house. So I asked her, you know, where he was, because I wanted to tell them what may have just happened to me. Pretty sure it did. She didn't know where he was. So I went outside the home to look for him, and I couldn't find him for a few minutes until I happened to notice him at the end of the road. He was sitting down on the curb, and he was crying. Grown man, 40 something years old at the time, sitting on the curb at the end of the road early in the morning crying. Obviously there was something very, very wrong. So I started asking him what the problem was, and he told me he had a very bad dream where he was abducted by aliens. Besides what happened in Texas, we never really talked about ETs together. Like I said, it wasn't big news back then. Not everybody was talking about it. People weren't coming out confessing blah, blah, blah as much, as they are these days. He was very distraught, and he started telling me a story about what happened to him. And he was telling me that he was in some sort of UFO, and the aliens made him drink some sort of vials of liquid, or choose one of these vials of liquid, and they were all different colors, and he drank one of them. And that's pretty much all he remembers. And, well, at least that's what he told me at the time. And nowadays he doesn't really remember much about the incident at all. Which I can understand why, because it seems to be after these abductions, you're a little bit out of it for at least a day or two. And it's kind of hard to remember things after that. Now, then I explained to him what happened to me that night, and I actually remember apologizing to him that I brought this home. They followed me from Texas, so it seems, and that was obviously very disturbing. So eventually, within that day, I had taken a shower, and I noticed on the back of my leg was, back of my knee, my right knee, was a round or an object underneath my skin. And it was hard. I never seen it there before. I mean, that's something I would have noticed if it was there or growing somehow or came to be at any other point in my life besides that morning, and there's just no way. So this thing's on the back of my knee, and I'm poking at it and prodding at it, wondering what it is, and I'm examining the cuts above my groin, which by the way I forgot to explain that the area around the wounds seemed to be stretched out a bit, as if there were tubes inside of me. And my only conclusion with that is that they extracted semen from me, which apparently is common in some abductions. What did I do after that? found this object on me. I find these cuts on me. So what did I do? I went to my personal doctor. I went immediately to that doctor and I showed him the thing on my leg first. And he examined it and he was like, you know, what is this? You know, how did you get this? And then I pretty much explained to him what may have happened, and he was actually okay with that. So then the doctor gets curious, and he asked me, you know, if anything else was on my body, and I told him about the incisions above my groin, and I let him examine those. And then that's when he asked me, you know, to go to a surgeon and have the object removed from my leg and bring it to him. I never did this. I never went to the surgeon. I've actually been asked by several surgeons over the years to have the object removed, and I didn't let anybody do it yet. Well, see, the thing is, this object was suddenly gone one day from that part of my leg. Now it's on my hip. How does that happen? You know, how does an object go from the back of your knee to your hip in one night? There must have been another abduction. That's all I can say, but I don't remember it whatsoever, so I can't account for it. Therefore, I'm not going to talk about it in this series. You know, I'm not going to add it to my list of abductions. So now this gets a little stranger. After that abduction, things for me started to change. So realizing that I have strange abilities now. Yeah, I'm very serious. Over the years, I have seen quite a few UFOs. I also have this very strange ability where I'm able to detect objects in the sky, like airplanes, jets, meteorites, satellites, without even knowing they're there. I will just get a feeling and I'll look straight up and read out the object. So I had this dream, and it seems to go along with that. It was a very, very vivid dream. One of many dreams that I've had over the years since that have been dreams of prophecy. I've been seeing the future, the past, the present. And I started writing them down for quite a lot of years, and I have quite the archive of these dreams. They're not normal dreams. They're very extremely vivid. They interrupt other dreams, and they have a tendency to come true. That's a whole nother story. That information is not currently online. It was for a few years, but I took it off because I wanted to rewrite it. I'm not going to get any more into that right now. The other ability would be sensing the presence of certain people. Certain people, I believe, that might in fact be abductees themselves. I seem to know when they're around me. And actually, there was one particular person recently that I ran into where I was able to once again prove this ability. Why do I have these abilities? How did I get them? I don't know. Where else? But from the abductions and why they did that to me and us. Quite honestly, we're all like that. Every one of us that have been abducted, we all have these visions and stuff. I even have inventions for devices of free energy, etc. I have these ideas in my head and I've been drawing them out for years. Again, let's not get too much into it. I'm just trying to give you an in-depth perception that there's a lot more going on to this than just a few abductions. Like, that's so easy to explain away or say. It's not. There's been a lot of things to happen over the years to all of us. Now, I mean, regardless of all this, I'm seriously going to tell you that I'm not going to say all of us, but we're all pretty much sane. I know a lot of people out there like to think that abductees are crazy or, something like that, and we're not. We're just regular people, and something really bleeped up happened to us, and most of us want to tell our stories, and I am one of those people that basically brave enough to tell the story and show my face doing it. Hi. So, I know I'm making a silly mockery out of this now. It's one of the ways that we've been able to relieve the stress of this is just to make fun of our own situation. Now, what's next? The third abduction. And this one's even stranger because I don't think it was a successful abduction. It seemed to be a failure, to be honest. That one happened in 2011. So quite a few years went by between the first two. At this time I was living in Fort White, Florida. Pretty much in the middle of the woods. It wasn't a very big community at all. In that area, it's just dirt roads and woods and a few homes. Welcome back. I had to pause the video because it decided to rain on me. So now we're here in my truck and you're going to take a ride with me while I finish telling the rest of the story. So, let's go. Now, I left off talking about the symbol. The symbol seems to lure them. The reason why I say this is because during the third or attempted abduction, I had drawn this symbol in the sand outside of the home that night, well, earlier that evening. Quite honestly, I have no idea why I did it. Just a spur of the moment thing. I decided to draw it in the sand. And then, you know, I retired for the night. I went in. And, so that night began. I was sleeping. And something seemed to be waking me up every few minutes. And, I was in between sleep and awake, and every time I slightly open up my eyes, I could have sworn I saw someone or something standing at the end of my bed in the darkness. I only saw it maybe once or twice out of the three or four times I was awakened. I don't know why I was awakened, to just, you know, like kind of like get a feeling like something's weird, so you kind of wake up. For a moment there, I could feel the carpet beneath the bed. I don't know how that was possible. I mean, I was laying on the bed and I literally felt like my arm was through the bed and touching the floor. I could feel it with my fingers, and it was that sensation of touching the rug that made me wake up. And I opened my eyes and I heard running, like footsteps running through the house, leaving the house in a hurry, like multiple footsteps, not like one person, but several, if there were people at all. And I heard the thump of the door close, so I immediately got up. I was home alone. And I ran to the door and looked at the door real quick, see if, you know, anybody broke in or something, and it didn't look like anything was odd, so I ran out the door and I ran out to the driveway to go look down the driveway. And mind you, it was a very long driveway, you know, 300 feet or so from the house to the dirt road at the end. And I looked down at the end of the driveway, and there was a pickup truck, a black pickup truck, sitting at the end of the driveway with the lights off. And, you know, about 2 seconds after I'm staring down the driveway, suddenly the lights turn on, and the truck takes off real fast. And as it did that, that's when I noticed there was a very bright light up in the sky that I could see at the end of the driveway. It wasn't a star. It was much too big. You know, a lot of people would say, oh, it might be Venus, Jupiter, you know, something like that. And no, much larger than that. And it suddenly lit up really bright, you know, like a flash, and it went out, gone. What happened? You know, did they try to abduct me and I woke up and they ran out the house and left? And if it's pretty obvious that, you know, I saw a UFO also, but was it the ETs that are in the house, or was it somebody else? Like, I know some people would like to say government, but I don't know. Supposedly there's something going on with, you know, government and aliens, you know, maybe they're working together or something. Was, you know, I can't really see, not that it's not possible, but I don't think aliens are driving around pickup trucks. It's possible, but, they have better vehicles than pickup trucks to drive around. So, what was that about? You know, and
the amount of time that it took for between these footsteps and when I got outside and looked down the driveway, it was within 10 to 15 seconds. So whoever or whatever was in the house ran so quickly, it's almost impossible for a human to do. And that's why I figured this was some sort of ETs that did this. There's just no way a person could run down the driveway that fast. So that's really all I remember of that experience. The other option, or theory, that is, of what could have happened, was they did abduct me, and they were bringing me back, and that's when I woke up. That's very possible as well. But in the story online, I leave it the question of they attempted to abduct me, but perhaps they didn't. Because afterwards, I wasn't out of it like the other times. I wasn't distraught for days afterwards. But I definitely know what happened that night. It was definitely an abduction attempt, like I say. And that's really all I have left to explain as far as the abductions go. I mean, again, over the years, I've seen things. I even had one flashback, which I wrote about, and it seems to be a flashback of the abduction in Ridge, New York. It's very detailed, and this came to me through an extremely vivid dream. So I wrote about it. I'm not going to tell you about it now. Again, because I don't know if it's fact or not. You know, this video, I'm just trying to give you, you know, the facts, everything I remember that I know to be true in reality. I'm going to leave that off here, and thanks for watching, listening. Take care.